The session 4 is about to begin. I'd like to welcome the deputations and administration. Fourth session would be about the report from the KG committee. Please put on your headphones if required. Channel 1 is Cantonese, channel 2 is English, and channel 3 is Putonghua. Please be reminded that all your oral and written statements would not be provided by the Electoral Powers and Privileges Ordinance. And I'd like attendees to be reminded that those in the public gallery, a set of guidelines have been attached with the Secretariat bundle, and you should have that set of documents in front of you. You can obtain this set of guidelines from our security staff as well. Everyone will have 3 minutes to speak. Please be concise. If necessary, you can supplement a written statement later on. Undersecretary, I guess you don't need to speak as of yet, so let's invite the deputations. First of all, from the ELC HK Amazing Grace Nursery School Parents Teacher Association, Dr. Karen Fong. Good afternoon. I'm a parent representative. I have 3 children, and I've been involved in early childhood education for 10 years, and I was happy that the pre-primary education voucher scheme was introduced, but the amount of subvention has been decreased, and in other words, we have to pay for school fees. And this new arrangement does not benefit children on the long-haul day school mode. And in 2013, I came to LegCo as a parent. And at a focus group at LegCo, we were able to relay the parents' comments. But during a briefing session last time, the government had not paid attention to the needs for long whole day KG education. In preschool education, 80% of the students are in whole day KGs. But as yet, this entire system was based on a half day school mode or KG mode. And the needs from whole day KGs has been ignored. And according to the reports, whole day KGs have their own shortfalls. But as you can see from the statistics, we have a great need in Hong Kong for whole day schools. I'd like to share the unfair aspects of the system as a parent. And in terms of the teacher's pay for the grassroots workers, the approach is problematic. In our school, our chef left in May this year. We are a long whole day KG, and as such, our chefs have to cook from breakfast till dinner. It's very difficult to hire a chef who is willing to work for such long hours. And assistant cook is only paid $12,000 to $16,000, and that's we can never hire anyone with this kind of pay. So the KG policy should not be based on half-day KGs and instead they should be based on whole day schools. From the Tonghua Group of Hospitals Early Childhood Services, Ms. Mary Wong. Good afternoon. And in order to satisfy the needs of school children, the government should establish a holistic approach. It should provide supports and subvention to long whole day KGs. And we also have some recommendations with regards to the pay of KG teachers. And the government should take reference from the median pay of KG teachers for schools with more experienced teachers. They have to apply for additional funds, and this is not satisfactory. Experienced KG teachers should be respected, but the reality is that their salaries are not safeguarded, and as such, the KGs have a very hard time hiring teachers. And this is not conducive to the long-term development of KG education. The government should establish a standard establishment, including principals, vice principal, teachers, and so on, so that appropriate resources can be provided. In optimizing the teacher-to-student ratio, the goal should be to promote teaching and operational efficiency. For long whole day KGs, teachers have to work very long hours, and separate subventions should be provided by the government to hire extra hands to prepare lesson materials, decorate classrooms, meet parents, and so on. Finally, we agree to the suggestion that additional subvention will be given to children with special learning needs. We should provide ample support, and this should not be limited to rehab services. An additional curriculum officer and social workers, as well as psychologists, should be hired. Curricula and teaching policy should be refined constantly, and the government should maintain close communications with schools, parents, and teachers, and follow up on the learning progress of children. Thank you very much. Next, from the Education Division of the Tonghua Group of Hospitals, Mr. Kenneth Wu. Thank you very much. I'd like to raise two issues. First of all, the scope of subvention, the subvention mode, and monitoring. In the report published by the KG committee, teaching quality seems to be an emphasis. Under the current subvention mode, how are we able to achieve quality teaching? This is something we should look at. In the report, above standard services have been repeatedly mentioned. So by the word standard, what are we actually looking at? Is there anything we can take reference from? I think we must be, it should be defined more specifically. In paragraph 7.2.7 in the report, we can take reference from past experience. But I think by doing so, the quality of KG education would be limited. And for school premises, classrooms, facilities, and so on, they are all interrelated, and they have a key role in determining the quality of KG education. This is something education practitioners should pay attention to. And in terms of subvention, part of it is calculated on the cost of each student, and part of it is calculated on the expenses of the school. And we have to consider whether schools have enough reserves to buy or upgrade their furniture and other equipment. And this affects the eventual delivery of KG education. And in terms of implementation, if a kindergarten decides to receive subvention, it must make a decision more than 1 year before the school term begins, because it affects the admission of students. And as such, the school sponsoring bodies need to spend time for planning and consulting its stakeholders before deciding whether or not to receive subvention. And there will be a consultation period after the report is published, so ample time should be given to these KGs. Next, from the Yuen Long District Kindergarten Heads Association, Ms. Lee Mei Kwan. Good afternoon. On the report on 15 years of free KG of free education, we have a few concerns. For whole day and long whole day KGs, how can we provide better support? Whole day and long whole day KGs have a role to play in our society, but they have not been mentioned in the report. In under paragraph 4.30 in page 6, the subvention given to half-day schools is only 25 to 30%, which is inadequate.
The decision in this regard has long or far-reaching implication on early childhood education. As regards the calculation of the types of schools for recruitment, in most cases they use half-day KGs as the basis. For the whole-day pupils, how do they do the calculation? Do they count one pupil or two pupils? We're worried that in terms of the number of pupils, it may not be very satisfactory. Usually a KG has six classes, so 360 pupils. But if part of the pupils are whole day, half long day, then I may not be able to attain the indicators. Then I can recruit the least number of teachers. So I think you should consider whether or not you should just count the number of pupils for the calculation of subvention. The report mentions interdisciplinary support teams. That's feasible. Some pupils may be waiting for services. I mean the SEN pupils. In the long run, for KG education development, you need to have professional teachers. The school environment, the manpower ratio, etc., all these should be improved. Just a few people from professional teams won't suffice. For example, targeting these SEN pupils, you should have a more perfect plan. You should first conduct assessment and then arrange them to enter different schools. Suitable training should also be provided to teachers and pupils. There should also be regular assessment so that the professional teams can provide the pupils with more focused services. I think this direction of development is more ideal. Next, Mr. Chung Chin Pang. Thank you, Chairman. I represent the PTA. In paragraph 4.5 of the report, it is said that KGs should be non-profit making and the curriculum guide published by the Education Bureau should be adhered to. I have three children. It is a basic right for children to receive education, and parents should be assisted in the choice of schools. So long as a curriculum has quality, I don't think it needs to adhere to the Education Bureau's curriculum guide. I think they should be free to have a school-based curriculum. Mainstream schools and non-profit-making schools may not be able to cover all pupils because there are bound to be learning differences among pupils. Maybe you should give up the voucher scheme. You shouldn't just apply the scheme to certain types of KGs, say non-profit-making KGs. So long as a KG has a good track record and is up to a certain standard, then it should suffice. And on a headcount basis, monthly subsidy should be released to families or to the educational institutions concerned. Then you'll be able to attain pluralism and flexibility, as mentioned by the report. And then healthy competition among KGs can be generated. As a result, all parties will improve. Next, Ms. Christine Fong. Thank you, Chairman. Concerning education, I think the first thing to strive for is 15 years of free education. At the moment, parents usually hope that their children can receive education earlier. But then at the community level, supply can barely cope. For early childhood education, in terms of school premises, I believe the Education Bureau should act more boldly. For early childhood education, due to the high rentals, there are huge difficulties for them. Should your policy not cover school premises as well? Earlier, there's a consultation exercise on international schools. Throughout the whole of Hong Kong, we will have sufficient number of international schools in the future. But for KGs, apart from hardware development, I hope that the Education Bureau will also focus on the development of software, namely teachers. The remuneration for KG teachers should be adjusted because to take care of small children is a heavy task. And we would like to unleash more manpower into the job market in this regard. And in terms of communicating with parents, schools need more resources. Frontline teachers need more resources, and ancillary arrangements within schools are also very important. Finally, earlier, I came into contact with the Association for the Hearing Impaired. More support should be offered to them, particularly assessment. Hearing assessment is rather expensive in the market. Parents do have financial difficulties. At the community level, we heard a number of difficult cases. There are not 6,000 places, but maybe in the community we need 1,000, not more. Next, Ms. Che Shuk-yin from Hong Kong Young Women's Christian Association, Athena Kindergarten. Thank you, Chairman. For half-day KGs, the report cites a number of overseas studies. For example, whole-day KGs have pros and cons. But those are not comparative studies. Those studies are on whole-day KGs only. So does that mean that half-day KGs don't have shortcomings? Of course not. We heard that certain problems would disappear by P3. Again, those studies were on whole day KGs only. What happened to half day KGs? So I think the report has improperly cited overseas cases. The report is lopsided in this regard. In fact, whole day KGs have very positive influence on parents and pupils. As for living environment and the demographic structure, Hong Kong is very different from overseas jurisdictions. Problems that occur in overseas jurisdictions may not necessarily happen in Hong Kong. After the implementation of the education voucher system, whole day KGs and nurseries have been able to meet the quality assurance standards of the Education Bureau. This is a very strong evidence that whole day KGs do have good quality and have attained the indicators set by the Bureau. So I think the report has generated two conflicts. On the one hand, it wants to introduce whole day KGs. At the same time, it cites overseas examples to rebut that. Secondly, the report says that it would like to unleash the working potential of women. But if half day KGs are to start for the 3 years olds, then it's actually telling parents not to work before their children attain the age of 3. So for the 3 modes of operation, half day, whole day, and long whole day, society has strong demands for them. A review should be conducted. In 2005, a major review was conducted at that time. Sorry, time's up for me. Next, Ms. Chan Chau-Hang. Good afternoon. I'm a retired principal of a long whole day KG. I spoke here in January. I thought that was my last time. Unfortunately, after reading the report, I have to speak again here. I've been engaged in KG education for 42 years, 35 years in a long whole day KG. Earlier, I told my colleagues that early childhood education has prospect. They should work harder. The government is dedicated to do something. A committee was set up and a report would be released soon. The government held frequent meetings with the profession. There are whole day, half day, and long whole day KGs. Our demands would be considered. Long whole day KGs would be fairly treated. But after the publication of this report, I seem to have cheated my colleagues. 3 hours is the threshold, the watershed for whole day and half day KGs. For the small KGs, they don't get suitable support for whole day, half day, and long whole day services. Long whole day KGs quotas for those below the age of 2.5 years receive very little subvention. And because of the calculation of the number of pupils, the professional hierarchy for KG teachers is unsatisfactory. Chances slim for such KG teachers to receive training. The government does not recognize the 2 to 3 year olds. Why should they be excluded? In one KG, there may be 2 different systems. Flexible management is used as an excuse not to set a minimum wage for KG teachers. Exceeding a certain threshold, extra application will have to be lodged with the government. That means the government has slighted the significance of early childhood education. It's already difficult for long-whole day KGs to recruit teachers. The government says that long-haul day KGs have experienced problems. We're asked to do more. Yes, we followed the government's advice. But after decades of hard work and strife, we've not got what we would like to have. So I'm very, very disappointed with today's result. The government does not respect the existence of long-haul day KGs. So we have the feeling that the government will give us something when it needs our help, but vice versa when our help is not needed. Next, Ms. Man Wen-Hing. I came here on the 11th of January. I really don't want to come again today. This is a very good Saturday afternoon, but I cannot spend my time with my family. Rather, I have to attend this public hearing. In fact, I've already retired. This public hearing has nothing to do with me. I've been served as a KG principal for 25 years. I've been with KGA Early Childhood Education for over 3 decades. Why am I coming here again? Because I saw this parent with 3 sons. The parent told me that the government favored the eldest son. The government does not like this adopted son, that is, long-haul day KG. Why is it so? Because that's also your son. At the January meeting during the second session, there was this story told by a speaker about the triplets. In fact, long-haul day KGs are quality KGs, but their size is small, so you slight them. You don't want to see them. Rather unwillingly, you're pressurized to consider them as well. These long-haul day KGs work for more than 10 hours a day. There are respite services, extended services, as well as services for the ASEAN pupils. They also take care of the 2-year-olds and 3-year-olds. Why should you be so unfair to them? Cinderella? We'll be back to her original by 12 midnight. Same for long-haul day KGs. They have to attend this public hearing. Why? Why should you be so harsh on them? This is your son as well. Long-haul day KGs can balance the needs of many families. Do you see this? Please open wide your eyes. Open up your heart. Look at them more seriously. They can balance the needs of other KGs. They've been helping a lot of families. Why should you disregard them? Why should you slight them? I hope that next time I won't have to come again. Well, thank you very much for the input of the 2 retirees. Ms. Chan Fengyi, well, yes, I also attended the January public hearing. Today I'm here not to celebrate the implementation of 15 years of free education. The government has slighted the requests of the KG sector. Many requests are not entertained. First of all, the subvention system is not adequate. The basic sponsorship is for half-day schools only. Long-haul day and whole-day KGs will get more resources. But the pupils and parents of whole day and long whole day KGs will not be fully subsidized. The report has not eliminated whole day and long whole day KGs, but should parents not be given the choice to opt for whole day and long whole day KGs if only half day KGs are subsidized? the whole day and long whole day KGs are slighted. They open up to 6 p.m. or 8 p.m. and have to offer refreshment to the pupils as well. So they need 20 to 30% extra cost. I asked a pupil whether it's very boring to stay in a whole day, a long whole day KG. The answer is no, because there are a lot of activities. It feels very happy. The parents of this child have to work, and the child was left to the grandparents. And also, children have not been accorded priority. The proposal in the report will not be helpful to them. Nothing is mentioned about supportive manpower. Now, I have a group with an SEN child. He needs a teacher-pupil ratio of 1:1. And this child also has emotional problems. So with no extra support, the teachers and the pupils will lose out.
顧到常組又顧唔到 SEN， 其實整體 SEN 啦、非華語啦， 常組係互相。
I think the division of labor is very important and they are linked together. And also there is no proposal for increasing the manpower of KG because we teachers also have to undertake administrative work. And I think administrative work are necessary. So the teachers would have to sacrifice the time they have with the children. So how can we put children first? I'm just pointing out the tip of the problem. The committee has been saying that you want to give the children a right start for all and put children first, but is it a good start? I don't think there is a definitive timetable and there is no roadmap. Next, Ms. Chen Fengyi, Chairman, members. What are these figures about? I think we have come here for 3 times and there have been 3 hearings. Well, I'm very fortunate to have attended the 3 hearings. For the 19th of March, we came here all in red clothes, and we are very hopeful. For 17th of January, we also come in red again. But today, what are we wearing? We are all coming in black. Black color indicates that we are very disappointed and angry with the report. We are also very worried. And on our t-shirts, you can see a broken heart. You can see a child with a broken heart. What we want to say is that don't let the children be brokenhearted. Well, I want to say, why am I worried, angry, and disappointed with the report? Because I think the content of the report does not meet the mission of education. In paragraph 4.2, it is saying that we should have a sustainable policy for to respect the uniqueness of KG education in Hong Kong, as well as the diverse needs of children, and to provide for equitable access to quality, holistic KG education. I think you're trying to widen the gap between the big and the small KGs. It will be very difficult for the small KGs to survive. You have not respected the uniqueness of the small KGs. I'm also very concerned that why free education is provided for half-day KGs, and then for children attending whole-day and long-whole-day KGs, they have to pay school fees. So I think this is not equitable education opportunities for all at all. Also, we are also not talking about full subsidy here, and we are not incorporating KG into the education system. But surprisingly, you want to control us. For example, the assessment reports of KGs have to be put onto the website. But this is not necessary for primary and secondary schools. You also require us to undergo 150 hours of training for the teachers, but you do not have support for these teachers going for training. So I would like to know the reasons why. I am a principal of a whole day KG. I'm very angry with the report because it has extracted the research from overseas out of perspective. This is very unfair for the whole day KGs. So our contribution in the past years have been disregarded. And I'm worried that the public will believe in this. If it is the case, then the whole day KGs will not survive at all. I think we're not talking about slogans here. We are hoping that we can achieve the vision. Lastly, I hope that I do need to come here for a 4th time for the hearing. And even if I have to come, I don't want to wear black clothes. And I hope that the heart will be wholehearted. And I'm very grateful for our seniors for giving us our views. We will try to carry on the mission, and we hope that one day we will succeed. Ms. Sito Wyman, I'm a principal of a KG. This afternoon, we have parents, students, and teachers, you know, outside LegCo. And we have asked the representative from Education Bureau to receive our petition, but we have been rejected. So I'm wondering whether this is an icon of the government. The government will refuse even to receive a petition from us. So it once again demonstrates how the Education Bureau is treating the KG education sector. So if the assessment team is coming to the KGs, then under Area 3, then I think they will fail. Because 15-year education is one of the key priorities of this term of the government, and you want to incorporate KG into the proper education system. But looking from the report, the stakeholders, you know, are also disappointed and concerned, because we can see that we are not putting children first. It is just a slogan. Even the choice for KG has not been granted for the children. For primary schools, we have whole day and half day, and the students and the parents can choose between them. And there is one thing in common for them, is that they all have full subsidy for the government. And for the professional development of teachers, there is also not much difference between half day and whole day primary schools. But if you look at the report, you can see that you are trying to marginalize whole day schools, and I think everyone can see that. So I think we should be looking at quality first. But then for KG, we are talking of at the quantitative aspect. So I can only say that this is a very unrealistic and impractical report. I don't think this is very difficult and to implement. Why is it so difficult to turn, you know, whole day into a fully subsidized KG? I think it all depends on whether the government is determined to do so. So I really hope that the government could practically and use their heart to look at early children education and to provide quality education environment for the children so that they can all have a good start. I do not wish that 15-year KG free education is just a slogan. Thank you. Next, Ms. Ting Wing Yi. I'm a KG teacher. I have looked at the report of the committee and say that there will be increase in staffing for the KG so that there will be opportunity for the teachers to enhance their working environment. And also there will be an increase in the teacher-student ratio. I think for some KGs, they have already gone beyond the ratio of 1 to 15. They have already employed senior teachers and other staff to support the teaching in KG. So I think already they have reached the ratio of 1 to 12. So I think there is no improvement here. And I doubt whether the committee has really conducted a comprehensive review in saying that the ratio should not be worse than 1 to 12, or are you just trying to deceive the public? And under the 1 to 12 ratio, you have already included the senior teachers and the vice principals. But for many KGs, the vice principals and the senior teachers are already very busy with other administrative and teaching work. But now you include them into the staffing ratio. So I don't think you are decreasing the teacher-student ratio at all. And the teachers are having a very heavy workload. They have to prepare for the teaching materials, and they also have to take care of extracurricular activities like open days and graduation ceremonies. So I think we are not trying to improve the teaching and the learning environment. And I hope that you will take into account for classes of K-1 students, if you stick to the ratio of 1 to 12, say during the PE class, if a student needs to go to the toilet, so what is the teacher going to do? Are you going to let this 3-year-old go to the toilet just by himself or herself? Or are you going to take the whole class to the toilet? So I think none of the above, you know, is conducive or fair to the students. Also, I think this question also touches on the support provided for the teaching staff and whether that is adequate. I do hope that for whole-day KG, they are valuable and they should be retained. You talk about releasing women to work, you talk about creating job opportunities, but you are not providing adequate support for whole-day KGs. The support is mainly given to half-day KGs. So the whole-day KGs will only be given very minimal support, and this goes contrary to your wish of creating more job opportunities. Thank you. That's all from me. Next, Ms. Chun Kanyan. Thank you. I want to talk about teacher professionalism. With the changes in time, I think everyone would agree that continuing education is important for KG teachers, and it will be conducive, you know, for their work. And in Chapter 4 of the report, it is stated that principals and teachers should be required to undergo 150 hours of training in 3 years, but then the report is silent as to the support that will be provided for KGs, and there is no other supportive measures. There is no career for the KG development, and there is also difference between the staffing structure of different KGs. So for individual teachers, they face difficulties in putting time and resources to undergo training. So how are we going to undergo this 150 hours of training in 3 years' time? There is no details in the report. If we're going to do so after work, then you are depriving the quality of the teacher's life, because we work almost 9 hours a day. Unlike primary and secondary teachers, we do not have empty classes that or time that we can prepare teaching materials. During the practical training and my current work, I come across a lot of KG teachers who are very tired after a day's work. And I really admire them for continuing to work as a KG teacher and to enhance themselves. But it is very sad that they do not receive any recognition. Also, there is no mention about the subsidy that teachers can apply for to undergo training. Well, I'm the lucky one because I can acquire my degree before I take up for work. But for those teachers who only have a diploma, they will have to pay for the school fees. Although there is the CEF and you have a ceiling of $10,000 for reimbursement, but this is not enough for KG teachers to undergo further training. So I wonder whether we can follow the example of the primary and secondary school and then provide subsidies for KG teachers so that KG teachers can go for training courses that are suitable for them. Also, there is no timetable for making it compulsory for KG teachers to have degrees. And I don't think this is a respect for the KG teaching staff. We hope that the committee will pay attention to teacher professionalism for KG teachers, and there will be long-term planning for this. Thank you. Next, Ms. Tai Seo Fong. Thank you. I'm a teacher. I'm also a mother. The government is trying to implement 15-year education, and you want to give free KG for our young children. But I wonder why whole-day schools would have to charge a fee for parents, but then for half-day schools, parents don't have to pay for the school fees. The committee said that it has looked into the situation, but I wonder whether they have looked into the need for whole-day schooling. The government is promoting that children should go for half-day schools and then spend the rest of their time at home, you know, and bond with their families. If the parents do not have to go to work, then of course this is a very ideal situation. But we are talking about a lot of parents who have to undertake work. Both of them have to go to work, so they only leave their children to the foreign domestic helpers. FDH are only here to cook for the children, clean the house, and do other cleansing services, but they cannot teach our children. Well, for the sake of convenience, FDH would try to put the toys of the children away, just put them in front of TV, feed them. And that's why, you know, our children do not know how to take care of themselves. And then also the parents do not feel comfortable to leave their children at home and go to work. So I wonder whether the government is aware of the need of our families. In the case of my KG, most of the parents are from the middle class, and they hire foreign domestic helpers, but they do understand that foreign domestic helpers cannot take up the teaching role. So under the voucher scheme, they are willing to pay some $4,000 to put their children to whole day KGs. But for parents who cannot afford this fee, what can they do? Because they cannot apply for fee remission. So what will be their choice? That will be only possible for them to go for half-day KG. So are you saying that whole-day KG is only meant for those families who can afford them? I would also like to suggest that the government should try to work out a timetable for subsidizing whole-day KGs. Next, Ms. Koh Suk Yee. I am a teacher, and I'm also a parent, and I have been engaged in early children education for 17 years, and I have acquired my degree, but this is a very difficult path for me because I have to take care of my family, and I have to work at the same time, and then also I have to take care of my homework because I'm studying for the degree. I have to pay for the degree course myself, but there is no benefit for me after acquiring for this degree. But why are we still trying to acquire the degree? This is because we are trying to fit in with the government to say that the KG teachers should enhance their professionalism, and this will help enhance the quality of our KG education. Well, we also require the parents and the principals to undergo 150 hours of training in 3 years' time. I have a lot of questions when I read this part. I wonder whether you really think that there is value that KG teaching staff are giving out. Is there any support for the KG teachers after they have acquired their degrees? Do you have a salary structure for degree KG teachers? You are not encouraging us to continue education and training. You are just giving us pressure. You are just saying that for non-degree KG teachers, they will be losing their jobs soon. Well, every one of us is trying very hard to do our job and try to receive the recognition from the government. But then what we can see is only delay and delay. I hope you will respect KG teachers. We are also members of the teaching staff, and we have given out a lot of efforts. What we have given out is no less than primary and secondary teachers. We want equal treatment. Next, Ms. Lee Suk Yee. I'm also a KG teacher. I'm very concerned about the report, especially the part concerning the salary structure. When we try to introduce the voucher scheme, we have tried to put away the salary structure for KG teachers. We can see that there has been a decrease in the salaries of KG teachers, or they are being stagnant. They are only stuck at 0.4 to 12. I think this is very demoralizing for the frontline KG teachers, and also it would affect our teaching quality. Having read the report, I find that there is no mention of working out a salary structure for KG teachers. So I want to ask, how can we ensure that the KG teachers will be well remunerated? Also, there is no concern as to how the school is going to adjust the salary of teachers. It can be adjusted upwards and downwards. There is no level of the adjustment, and there is no control mechanism at all. The Education Bureau has always been saying that early childhood education is important, is part of our education system. But for primary and secondary teachers, they have a salary structure. But I think it is very unfair not to have such a salary structure for KG teachers. And you will be losing good quality salary KG teachers. Also, there has been suggestion that there should be a safety net for KG teachers. I think this is very unnecessary. Why are you doing this? Why don't you just work out a salary structure? Why are you going the difficult way? Why does the KG have to apply for additional subsidy to cater for the salary of the more senior teachers? Is there a mechanism for applying for such additional subsidy? Will all such applications be approved? Will there be a limit? All these questions are not answered in the report. And I think you're only increasing administrative work for the KGs. This is very cumbersome. Why don't you just draw up a salary scale? It is also mentioned in the report that flexibility should be given to KG, but why don't you need similar flexibility for primary and secondary school teachers and civil servants? The latter all have salary scales and pay structure. I think it is just because the Education Bureau do not want to drop a salary scale for KG teachers. I really hope that you would map out such a salary structure for KG teachers and answer all the questions above.
Next, Ms. Yip Mei K. I'm also a frontline KG teacher. I've been on the job for 13 years and I've stayed in the same KG throughout. And why is this the case? Why didn't I choose to go somewhere else? That's actually an issue we are all facing. I'm not sure if the chairman knows the reason. Would our experience be considered? Would we be safeguarded if we decide to go somewhere else? I've already finished a degree course, but still, we do not enjoy any protections. And right now, the funding is based on the median pay of KG teachers, and according to the report, the one-off funding can improve the competitiveness of KG teachers and increase flexibility. As other deputations mentioned, why don't we have a pay scale for KG teachers when we already have one for primary and secondary school teachers? This is unfair, and this is something we should consider. Basically, most teachers would have reached the median pay after 6 or 7 years of work. And the highest pay point is actually a limiting factor for us. And in some cases, we would have to accept lower salaries. Is this really fair to KG teachers? We already have one-off subventions in the welfare sector, and we have already seen a lot of issues. For example, divisions within colleagues and so on. Why are you introducing this approach to kindergartens? And the entry requirement for KG teachers will be degree holders, but the implementation details have not been mentioned in the report. But according to the policy address, starting from 2015 to 2016, the ratio of degree KG teachers will be increased gradually, and the ratio of degree holding KG teachers will be increased from the current 50% to 55, 60, and 65% after 2016. Why didn't the government establish a roadmap for KG teachers to attain the degree qualification? Thank you very much, Ms. Cho Mei Seung. Good afternoon. I'm also a teacher. In recent years, training for KG teachers have evolved from the earlier QKT to the current degree programs. The committee asked the teachers to complete the training within a specified time frame, but yet no support has been mentioned in the report. The professional training of teachers lack a holistic long-term plan, and the government does not understand the feelings or pressure faced by many teachers. For those who wish to become teachers soon after completing their degree programs, they face very little protection. And would they be would they have enough confidence to become teachers? Thank you very much. Next, Ms. Leung Oi Wah. Good afternoon. I'm a KG teacher. In 2012, C.Y. Leung mentioned 15 years of free education in his manifesto, and the KG report was published this May, and I'm very disappointed. I have decided to break my silence on behalf of KG teachers to voice my dissatisfaction. In terms of manpower, the committee recommended introducing extra staff in order to improve the ratio, the teacher-student ratio to 1 to 12. Apparently, moving from 1 to 15 to 1 to 12 is an improvement, but other posts such as vice principals and senior teachers have all been incorporated. So the ratio of 1 to 12 is actually nothing more than a beautiful figure. Why is the committee deceiving us? I'd like to share my experience from work. The current teacher ratio at my KG is 1 to 14. My working hours span from 8 a.m. when the kids go to school. I'm the only teacher, and as such, I cannot possibly take care of the needs of all the kids. Sometimes I don't even have time to drink water or go to the toilet. And we have no time at all to prepare for lessons. And after the kids go home, we still have a lot of work. For example, prepare for lessons, marking assignments, and so on, or decorating classrooms. Sometimes we need to host meetings with other teachers to prepare for special events, and we don't even have time to go home and take a rest. Even after we go home, we still need to continue our work a lot of the times. I hope the government understand our workload. And as such, in calculating the teacher-to-student ratio, they should not count the vice principals and senior teachers. You should provide empty or vacant lessons for teachers. And I hope the government can stop contradicting themselves. Early childhood education is very important for our students, and you should also pay attention to the needs of teachers. The amount of funds we receive are much less than those of primary and secondary schools, and you should implement 15 years of free education and rather than giving us bits and pieces. Ms. Fu Heng Hoi, I'm a teacher as well. Like some of the teachers who spoke before me, I feel that we should have a pay scale for KG teachers. After the PVS was in force, one-off subventions were given to schools, and schools are free to establish their own pay levels. And as such, teachers are no longer protected by a standard pay scale. And the number of years of experience is not taken into account. And as such, the salaries of teachers have become arbitrary, and they are fluctuating. And you're not valuing the experience of our teachers. We are not going anywhere with our current approach in terms of salary. The salaries are now market-oriented. If teachers decide to move to another KG, their salaries might drop, and as such, they have very little options. And eventually, the professionalism of the KG teachers is being compromised. And a lot of efforts have been put in assessing the performance of teachers, and this system has led to a lot of disputes and competition within the school, and the spirit of teamwork has been compromised as well. And at the end, the students would suffer. And from 2011 to 12, 58% of teachers in whole-day schools have remained at points 4 to 12. A lot of teachers were disappointed and decided to move to other jobs. Ms. Sok-man, good afternoon. Since our chief executive proposed 15 years of free education, I had high hopes. I thought the government emphasizes preschool education and KG teachers, but after the report was announced, I have been very disappointed. Improving the teacher-to-student ratio has been one of the goals. The improvement, the goal is to improve it from 1 to 15 to 1 to 12. In theory, it's a good thing. But when I look into the details, the 1 to 12 ratio includes senior teachers and vice principals. In effect, their primary work are administrative in nature, and they are not involved in teaching. So in other words, the burden of the existing teachers would be even higher. And this ratio of 1 to 12 is acceptable to older kids, but for those under 3, the teachers would have a great burden because these young kids cannot take care of themselves and they require support from teachers. I suggest the requirements to be amended so that the 1 to 12 ratio doesn't include senior teachers and vice principals. I hope there's room for adjustment. Secondly, the report mentioned long whole day KGs. 1 to 3 additional support offices will be provided to deal with the extended opening hours and improve caring quality. But what kind of staff are we going to receive? Are they teaching assistants or support staff? Teachers must be qualified before they can provide teaching to young kids. For unqualified staff, it's difficult to convince parents that they can provide comprehensive teaching service. I hope the report can better clarify the roles of these additional staff. Thank you very much. Next, Ms. Chen Mei-kun. Good afternoon. I hope the government will implement 15 years of free education as soon as possible and cancel PEVS. They should also provide extensive funding for whole-day schools and introduce more subvention modes, and they should cover half-day, whole-day, and long whole-day KGs. I hope the government would not ignore the needs of young school children and their family situations, especially for long whole-day KGs. The government should establish, should enhance caring services and admit more SEN students. The SWD should provide more support and facilities. We have these KGs because of needs in our society. For instance, children with working parents. For respite service, additional teachers are required and more support teachers are required. But since the government is not providing any direct subventions to these schools, they are only providing isolated funds to hire extra staff. They might not be properly trained in early childhood education, and as such, they cannot be counted upon. I once worked in a child center. It was located in a public rental estate, and there's great demand for respite and childcare services. But due to restrictions in the teacher-to-student ratio, we only had administrative staff and we did not have any support offices, and the burden had to be taken up by teachers, and they had to take care of these young children. And since these young children are not familiar with the school surroundings, they need some time to get used to it. And in effect, the teachers have to both teach and take care of these kids. And as such, they face even more pressure. I hope the government can understand the needs of preschool education practitioners, and the government should hire more support officers to relieve the work burden of teachers. Ms. Yuan Chao Mui. Good afternoon. I'm a frontline KG teacher, and I'm entering 10 years of work. I have worked in long whole day KGs before, and I look forward to consultation from the government, but I'm very disappointed with this report. The government is being unfair to whole day KGs in Chapter 7 of the report. The government acknowledges the need to improve the teacher-to-student ratio, and they have acknowledged the importance of long-day schools, and they intend to provide more long-day KG places, and they want to release the productivity of women in our society. But in terms of subvention, the government is only providing assistance to half-day KGs, but not whole-day schools. And in the report, it said that whether services are provided or are subvented by the government, working parents can opt for whole-day and long-whole-day KGs. But that's obvious because these parents have no choice at all. But it doesn't mean that they don't care. A lot of countries are now providing free KG services. Even Macau is doing it. So I don't understand why it's not being done by the Hong Kong government. Is it because of money or other factors? Right now, only half-day, only partial subvention is given to these schools, and a lot of the costs are being borne by the parents themselves. The government said they want to help, but in reality, they are doing nothing to help. So what should the parents do? Is it that you feel that most of these parents are from the middle class and they won't have any financial burden? In the future, the cost of raising a kid might be even higher than $4 million. I've thought about this question myself. How much money would I need to raise my kids in the future? And should I have babies? So I suggest the government to set up a roadmap in order to implement the goal of providing early childhood education. The government should put in more resources to support long whole day KGs, or let's call it extended services, for the 1 to 3 extra officers, provided what are their qualifications. If you have children studying in these KGs, can you rest assured that your children will be taken good care of? So first of all, we have to understand the qualifications or experience of the additional officers. Next, from the Hong Kong Professional Teachers Union, Ms. Kwan Shuk Ling. Good afternoon. I would like to speak on the lack of a standard pay scale for teachers. Earlier this year, a lot of teachers have voiced their opinion, but eventually the report did not provide a standard pay scale. In a way, you are destroying our expertise or careers. The committee provided salary ranges for four grades. Apparently, you are providing more protection to KG teachers, but the salary ranges are not dependent on experience and qualifications, and as such, the salaries depend on the market. And a lot of teachers have to bear with subpar salaries. When 15 years of free education is implemented, their salaries might be increased. But since their experience is not taken into account, they might be deprived of what they deserve. This is deceiving. And right now, the standard is to have 300 half-day schools, and there's a lack of coordination with KG teachers, and it's very, very difficult for us to attract new blood. The one-off subvention is based on the median salary of KG teachers. But since the scale of KGs is even smaller than those of the welfare groups, there's little room for improvement, and the salaries of KG teachers will only be further deprived.
The committee proposes that the highest salary for KGTs should be at a particular level, but I think that level cannot be reached at all. KGTs should accumulate experience. So KGTs are precious assets for society. However, the procedures for application for KGs are not clear. At the moment, KGs already have a lot of documentary work to do. So application procedures will be an extra burden on KGs. And after applying, we don't even know whether or not our applications will be approved. If our applications are not approved, KGTs may have to be dismissed. This has also posed a very huge pressure on the KGTs. That's unfair to them. Next, Ms. Low Lai Fong, principal of ELCHK Amazing Grace Nursery School. Thank you, Chairman. I believe our colleagues have read the report in depth. Something is strange and absurd. The theme is Children First, a Right Start for All. And this morning, we had an induction activity for parents whose children are to come to our school. So I drew their attention to certain points. And the parents were actually appalled. I told them this report has been released. In future, parents will only get 3 hours of subsidy. They won't get direct subsidy for 15 years of free education. They're stunned. They asked why. Why they don't have the right. Why they're not entitled to the subsidy. In fact, we all find that strange. In Hong Kong, 30% of KGs are whole day and long whole day KGs, a third of them. Why is it that in this report, 3 hours is set as the threshold? Why is it that you don't consider the actual needs of the parents in the distribution of subsidies to parents? The Education Bureau smeared us. It did brainwashing. API said that 3 hours is the best. The best is to go home and to be served by the mothers of the children. Let me ask you here, how many of you here take care of your children at home? My children are now at university. They've always been in long whole day KGs. I've never served them at home for one day. So you have to look at this actual need of society. For the Education Bureau, why doesn't the government face this problem squarely? Why can't you meet parents' needs? The report mentions the benefits of half-day KGs, as well as the adverse impact of long-haul day KGs. I've been in the profession for 30 years. When long-haul day KG pupils left our KGs, their parents were very grateful to us. They were confident in us. They found it very comfortable to leave their children with our teachers. I've never heard any adverse impact of long-haul day KGs from parents, so I really want the Bureau to reconsider this. What are the needs of our parents, and to offer suitable subsidies and assistance to parents and pupils? Next, the Association of Evangelical Free Churches of HKEFCC, AGC Abundant Grace Nursery School, Ms. Cho Si Man, childcare worker. I'd like to speak on learning support. At the moment, there are 7,000 outstanding applications for rehabilitation services. 10% of the cases will have to wait for 13 months. SEN pupils have not received suitable support. For their long-term development, there's adverse impact on them. For KGs, for those pupils who are diagnosed with a need but are still waiting, there are quite many of them. As for emotional problems at school, as one of the speakers said, we need to have a teacher-pupil ratio of 1-to-1, but we don't have sufficient support. So very often, teachers are actually hands-tied. There's nothing they can do. So I think you should provide resources and assistance to them. You should offer in-school rehabilitation services. Extra subsidy should be offered. Extra manpower should be given to us, including special teachers and psychologists. In the long run, you should increase the number of rehabilitation quotas, enhance the assessment for disabled children, and to extend the service to KGs. At the same time, you should increase the number of resident social workers. As for teachers, most KGTs have already been trained to teach SEN children. But then KGT's confidence is not enough in this regard, because usually just 1-to-2 modules are offered to them at the theory level. Teachers lack practical experience, and there are not that many places, training places for teachers. Sometimes they have to pay for their training courses, so you should encourage more KGTs to be trained. The situation will then improve. The government has lighted special education and obstruct the implementation of integrated education. So long-term review should be conducted. Besides, for the part-time teachers, they are only paid at the median salary of KGTs. Support from professional teams and resource allocation from the government should improve. You know, you have to understand that KGTs are jacks of all trade, so to speak. They have to do everything, so they need more assistance. Next, Ms. Cheng Oi Kam, principal of EFCC Pong An Nursery School. In paragraph 2.17 of the report, it is pointed out that some studies point to the fact that long-haul day KGs have shortcomings. You should review the value of long-haul day KGs. It's not true that they have low cost effectiveness. Very often, we have excessive expectation on the KG pupils. I've served in long whole day and long whole day KGs. Families, particularly middle class families, want to send their children to direct subsidy schools or renowned schools. Excessive expectation doesn't originate from long whole day KGs, but the social economic status of parents. The report also says that primary curriculum should be adopted in KG. This is absurd. External assessment had been conducted in the territory, and long whole day KGs were highly regarded by Education Bureau. For those covered by the Education Voucher Scheme, I don't think they will implement primary curriculum. So I think these allegations are not just directed at long whole day KGs, but the Education Bureau. There's another paragraph that says that long whole day KGs have reduced the parenting time. 80% of our parents, for example, will, after 4:30 p.m., bring their children to parks to play, and then on Saturdays and Sundays, they'll bring their children to libraries. So these are parenting time. Conversely speaking, for those who study in half-day KGs, very often they're accompanied by mates rather than their parents. They know their mates more than their parents. Well, this is a rather common phenomenon among middle-class families. So short parenting time is the result of long working hours of the parents, not long whole day KGs. We don't require pupils to stay up to 6 p.m. or 8 p.m. This is to provide an alternative for working parents only, so that they can set their minds at ease. So that's one of the values of long whole day KGs. Next, Ms. Chen Kuan-Yi. Well, I'm a teacher of long whole day KG. Previously, I also served a half-day KGs. I think the government is lopsided towards half-day KGs, which get more resources. I'd like to tell you the value of long-whole day KGs. In paragraph 2.17 of the report, shortcomings of long-whole day KGs are mentioned. Well, guides published by the Education Bureau tell us to allow pupils of diversified development. Long whole day KGs give children ample time to teach. We allow our pupils, for example, in our school to explore certain issues. Such learning activities need ample time. So this is the merit of whole day and long whole day KGs. Am I saying that half day KGs are not good? No, I think they have their individual pros and merits. And for long whole day KGs, they have a full day to teach their pupils. For long whole day pupils, they have their meals and afternoon tea at school. So their learning opportunities are rather strong. So in this regard, they have a competitive edge over their half-day counterparts. The report should not just favor half-day KGs. They should take care of the different needs of different families and schools. In the report, long-whole day KGTs are not properly protected. They work much longer hours than half-day KGTs. On the average, they work over 9 hours per day. And under the education voucher system, long-haul day KGs have a higher rate of manpower turnover. Long-haul day KGs provide longer hours of learning and activities for their pupils, but their KGTs do not enjoy a comparable pay scale. So you should provide for a sustainable hierarchy. So long-haul day KGTs should have a better pay scale. Next, Ms. Ko Yuk-ping. I'm a KGT as well as a mother. In Chapter 2 of the report, it's pointed out that KG education is a very important stage for the holistic development of a person. I have to point out that support for early childhood education has not been enough. At the moment, we have many students, many small children waiting for assessment and identification. They have special needs. For non-Chinese speaking pupils, you should adopt the threshold of 6 SEN KG pupils who should be entitled to one extra teacher for support. Do you think the support for SEN pupils should be lower than that for non-Chinese speaking pupils? I'm also a mother. From birth to 18 months old, children are monitored by maternity clinics. But after 18 months, such services will be suspended up to 4 years old when children attend school. During that stage, we rely on mothers to identify any problem in the children. From P1 onwards, assessment on health, emotions, learning, and so forth are conducted. So why should this be lacking after 18 months to 2 to 3 years old? From 2 to 3 years old onwards, teachers will be responsible for monitoring and observation. From observation and monitoring to telling the parents that the child has problems, and then up to the time of treatment, the golden period may have been missed. So why doesn't the government enhance support for SEN KG pupils? Why is it that apparently this has never been mentioned? I suggest that the Education Bureau enhance support in this regard. Just now, many teachers cited actual examples, say, one teacher to 10 SEN pupils. Next, Ms. Chen Wai-yi. Good afternoon. I'm also a frontline teacher. I'll speak on the professionalism of teachers today. Every day I work more than 9 hours. I teach at the AM session and then the PM session. Besides, there are a lot of documentary work. At night, I am studying for a bachelor's degree at Baptist University. Why is it that with such a heavy workload, I still want to further my studies? I think KGT's training is directly affecting the quality of teaching. So I insist on further studies. In the report, I see no clear recommendation for the professional development of teachers. The report does not mention anything about how to assist teachers. KGTs have to face expensive tuition fees. They have to spend time at night to further their studies. But without such training, are they still professional teachers? The report wants to upgrade the qualification for KGTs to degree holding level. In future, will non-degree holders be eliminated from the profession? I think you should implement measures as soon as possible to help with the professional training of KGTs. Next, Ms. Leung Po Yu. Thank you. I'm a senior teacher in a long-holiday KG. Very often, strategically, we can look at the actual operational needs of the school in making decisions. But when I read the report, I found no concrete proposals on KG establishments. Does that mean that KGs and pre-primary schools have a great deal of freedom? Apparently not. That's unfair to us. Take senior teacher as an example. I'm also a senior teacher. KGs with 600 small children would most have 5 senior teachers. But for primary schools, they say there's no such need.
Well, I think for the senior teacher, we have a lot of responsibilities. We have to take care of administrative matters and then also to assist the teachers and also to help the children studying in our KG. So I think, does that mean that, you know, for the small KGs, we don't have to undertake such work? But the fact is that we are doing so. So I think for long whole day KGs, we usually admit 100 students, so I'm wondering whether we will always be classified as small KGs and that we don't have to do administrative work in addition to teaching work. So if you say that there is no need for the small KGs to have certain posts, then I think the workload will be just be given to the teachers. I think the teachers are all heavily engaged and have a lot of work pressure. When we talk about the student-teacher ratio and improving it, it seems that we're talking about trying to ease the workload of teachers. But if we're going to a ratio of 1 to 12, that already includes the senior teachers. But when it put to practice, the senior teacher often has to be engaged in administrative work. So the ratio of student to teachers in the classroom actually doesn't have any improvement at all. Well, for the teachers in the classroom, I think that there should be a good ratio. And also, you know, you have to take into account that teachers also have their family commitments and they may fall sick. So when the teachers need to take leave to attend to their personal matters, then the senior teachers will have to come in to help. Then, under such scenario, who's going to do the administrative work? So I think this is very unreasonable. Although it is stated in the report that we can try to hire support staff, but there is no details about these support staff and are they qualified teachers? So I hope that you will really look into the teacher-student ratio again. Next, Ms. Zhong Yunyi from the Grace Nursery School, principal of the nursery school. Thank you. I have been engaged in early childhood education for over 30 years, and this is my first job, and I think this is going to be my last job as well. This is my lifelong career. I like my job a lot, because I think that I can apply what I have learned in my working environment, and then also I find value in what I'm doing. Well, I have been working in long whole day schools for some 30 years. So there is time for me to look at the development of a child, you know, during the day, and I can try to give them sufficient support in terms of their social skills, their emotional issues, and then how to enhance them to take care of themselves. Our children know how to tie their shoelaces, use the chopsticks, eat by themselves, and take care of themselves. So they are very different from the ordinary children in Hong Kong per se. So I'm very proud of this. And I can see that long whole day school is also contributing to society, particularly for families. where both parents are working. And this is in line with government's objective of unleashing women to work. And they will help to enhance the financial status of their families. So I think a lot of value in this. Well, I think the report has high objectives, but I don't think it has very concrete measures to implement them. You are using just 3 hours as the basis for calculating the subsidy for KGs, and you disregard the contribution of the long-haul day school. You're just giving us an additional subsidy of about 25% to 30%. I think this is really, really inadequate. For long-haul day KGs, we also have to serve the community. For example, we provide respite service. We make sure that children are not left at home alone. And then also we try to meet the needs of parents who have irregular working hours. I think the long working day code, the LWD KGs, we operate very long hours, starting from 8 in the morning until 6 or 8 p.m. And also we take into account students with SEN. So we are trying to hope to help these children so that they can go back to mainstream schools. I think the report has disregarded the function and the contribution of long-haul day KGs and disregarded the needs of the parents who are sending their children to long-haul day KGs. It has quoted a lot of points about the research on the sort of disadvantages or the shortcomings of the long-haul day schools or whole-day schools. It seems to be giving the message that, you know, whole-day and long-haul-day KGs in Hong Kong are not doing that good. But I think if you look at other reports, I think generally there is positive comment about the whole-day KGs in Hong Kong. Thank you. Next, Mr. Jackie Low. Thank you, Chairman, Deputy Secretary, friends. I think the Policy Secretary has stated on the 18th of June this year that in the coming 2 years, the government will be dedicated to focus on developing Hong Kong's economy and improving our livelihood. And I think, you know, for such a support, it should not be just be done for 2 years, but a continuous effort, so that there will be sufficient efforts shown. The commission has given a report on 3KG, and the Education Bureau is now listening to public views on the report. I think the central government should require the various bureaus to provide input on how to improve the economic development and livelihood of Hong Kong. Then I think if we just stick to half-day school, then you will not be able to unleash, you know, the workforce. I think the mode of operation for long-haul day KG will be able to unleash women to work and to ensure that the parents of young children will be devoted to their work and try to get hold of the opportunities that the CE has mentioned about and contribute to the economic development of Hong Kong. The Secretary for Education should give recognition to diversity in KG education, and I hope you will incorporate whole-day education and long-haul-day KG into the education system and give them support. And I also hope that the Education Bureau and being accountable officials, they should have the political determination and be brave to raise to the CE and the FS measures with financial implications to implement 3KG education so as to honor the manifesto of the CE. I think the central government should also request other bureaus to provide policy measures. And I think this is not just a one-stop policy measure. You should be looking at various measures to help the situation. You are giving additional resources of about 0.6% for the long-haul day and whole-day schools. And I don't think you are really looking into the equation well. The parents are taxpayers, and why don't you do better and give them more subsidy, and they have so that they don't have to pay school fees? Next is from the Unison, Miss Phyllis Chan. I think it is admitted in the report that about 4% of the PEVSKGs have admitted non-Chinese speaking students, and it accounted for about over 50% of the total enrollment. And I think from the education perspective, it is also admitted this is not a good move, and it is not helpful for them to learn Chinese. Hong Kong Unison Limited think that this is actually a de facto racial segregation across the KGs. But the committee has not proposed any measures to rectify the situation, and they allow the KGs to continue to adhere to their admission policy. I think this is a racial discrimination, and we are very concerned about the situation. And I hope that the Education Bureau will provide clear policy for the KGs to admit students. And so the language for interview and admission should be specified. And there should be guidelines, you know, for these KGs when they admit students and interview the students, so as to ensure fairness and equity in terms of admission, and to protect the interests of NCS students so that they will have equal opportunity to receive free and quality KG education. We also think that the committee's recommendation of additional resources for KGs should not be confined only to KGs receiving more than 8 NCS students. There are a lot of KGs who have admitted NCS students and they need extra support. For example, in terms of interpretation and translation of documents, and then also they need extra teaching staff to help out for these students. If you only provide subsidy that is enough for 8 NCS students, I think it's grossly inadequate. Hong Kong is a very diversified society, and I think the students also have diversified learning needs. We hope the Education Bureau will provide inclusive education training for teachers and students, teachers and principals of the KGs. The committee is supportive of the move that NCS students should be admitted to normal schools as soon as possible and integrate with society. But I think right now there is lack of information for these services. So a lot of NCS students' parents, they do not have access to such information and they do not know what services are available. So we hope that under free KG education, Education Bureau will provide information to these parents on an equitable level. Thank you. Next, Ms. Zhang Xiaolin. I am a single mother. I want to speak in Putonghua. I'm living in Kowloon Tong now. In order to encourage, to allow my child to go into a kindergarten, I have to travel across the territory every day. Before my child goes to kindergarten, I've been working and looking after my child at the same time. So it is very hard time for me, and I felt sick all the time. I have headaches. When I'm taking care of my child, I do not have any support, and I have a hard time taking care of my child. When my child goes to half-day school, when my child feels sick, I don't have time to take care of him, and I can't get out of work. For the grassroots families, they have a lot of needs. I think it has a lot of impact on them. So I have a personal feeling for this. I know it is very difficult. During the time when the child goes to kindergarten, I think it is a difficult 3 years for the children. And I think they need a lot of support from the government and also from the education sector. When we are taking care of the child, you know, and when the weather is unstable, you know, they have to take a nap anytime and they have to go to the toilet anytime. We are living in subdivided flats and safety is a concern. You know, the children, they cry all the time. They don't have space. They can only stay on the bed. So it is a very difficult life for us. So I hope the schools will provide emotional support for them as well. And I do hope that there will be a lot of support for these children. And I think under the KG environment, it is safe for the child, and I think the parent will feel more comfortable. We all hope that our children will have a happy livelihood. I don't have time to look after my child all the time. And we feel very tired. So I feel helpless all the time. I know people here know a lot about the situation. Later on, my child goes to a whole day KG, and then I can go to work. Lastly, I want to point out that for the grassroots families, and especially the single-parent families, we really support whole-day education. Thank you very much. Thank you, Chen. I want to introduce myself. My name is Jen, and I'm from Sunshine Pool. I have two children, and they are very small. My eldest son goes to K1. My husband is a salesman. Every month, he can bring home about $6,000 to $7,000. We live in a subdivided flat. The rent is already some $5,000. So there is a lot of pressure for us. And I do hope that I can take a part-time job to help out. But then I am taking care of two children at the same time. And I cannot go to work. My eldest son goes to KG, and the school fee is relatively cheap. But then it's almost some $4,000, and there are miscellaneous charges like, you know, textbooks charges, school uniform, and activities charges. And the KGs also ask us to buy learning kits like DVDs. A lot of parents buy these DVDs, so in order for my child to have the same learning environment, I have to buy these as well, but they are very expensive. So I have to borrow money from my friends in order to make ends meet. Now for children going to K2 and K3, they have a lot of homework which requires access to the computer, and we have to get hold of newspaper clippings. So I think for kindergarten students, they are just like primary and secondary school students. They have to buy stationery, textbooks, they have to have access to the computer. And I hope that the government would implement 15-year free education and then provide subsidy for KG students at the same level as that of primary and secondary students. And I hope that there will be textbook subsidies and subsidies for getting access to computers and the internet. We have to wait until 2017 or 2018 in order to have free 15-year education. So I think this is a long wait for low families like mine. And for these coming years, I hope that the Education Bureau and the CCF can provide early subsidies for KG students. Thank you. Next, Ms. Li Xiaochen. Well, sorry, I cannot speak in Cantonese. I hope you understand what I'm talking about. I want to speak in Putonghua. I am from Tin Shui Wai area, and I have a daughter who is going to whole day KG. I choose whole day KG because there are a lot of advantages. Because, you know, the teachers take good care of my children there. And I have a full-time job and I have long working hours. So I cannot leave my child at home. And if I leave them at home, they are only being taken care of by grandparents. So I would prefer that they be taken care of by teachers at KGs and that they would learn more. I think for whole day KGs, it is also possible to train our children so that they become independent. Because, you know, if they are at home, they are being taken care of by parents, grandparents, or the maids. But in the school, in the KG environment, they have breakfast, lunch there, and they have afternoon nap there, and the children learn to take care of themselves. I think in the KG environment, they can learn to be independent and to take care of themselves. So I think these are the advantages of whole day school and long whole day KGs. And also, they can learn how to interact with other students. At present, a lot of children do not have too many siblings, so they are quite lonely at home. But if they are at the school, they can share their stationery and other stuff with other children. So I think they can learn how to share with others. And I think they like to be at schools. And then also, I think whole day KG will be more similar to the primary school environment. So that's why I've chosen whole day KG for my child as well.
When considering whether to admit our kids to whole day schools, we have to consider the factor of money as well. If we go for half day KGs, if we go for whole day KGs, we would have to pay a lot more in costs. We might have to hire a nanny since we are working parents and we have to pay for rent and other fees. And if we opt for half day KGs, we have to pay a lot in extra tuition after school. So all these amount to considerable amounts, and this represents a great burden for grassroots families, and it's not affordable for us, and at the end we chose whole day KGs. For kids with where both parents are working, the support from the government is very important. I hope under the 15-year free education policy, the government should provide subvention to whole day KGs in order to alleviate our burdens. Next, from the Alliance for Children Development Rights, Ms. Ho Yu Ying. Thank you, Chairman. We are an NGO who work with grassroots families. And we have a few questions for the Education Bureau with regards to the report of the Free KG Committee. Over the past 2 years, the government introduced the PEVS scheme and made adjustments to school fee remission. But at the same time, the school fees have been raised. Every year, the raise was 12.5%, which is very high. In 2015 to 16, the school fee is over $67,000. So even with the PEVS and school fee remission, grassroots parents have to pay more than $19,000 for whole day KGs. So the government's policy is actually not helping grassroots families with kids in whole day schools. For working parents, they would be given priority by whole day KGs. But very often for these families, either the mother or father has to stay home to take care of their kids. And as such, the chances of kids entering whole day KGs have been compromised. How can the government ensure that the kids can enter the KGs they want? And under the current school fee remission mechanism, the assets cap for applying for remission is even lower than the poverty line. And at the LegCo's Finance Committee, the families under the poverty line should be given full school fee remission. And those earning median family income should enjoy subvention. When will the Education Bureau conduct a review so that parents with kids in whole-day schools can enjoy subventions? Before implementing 15 years of free education, the government should review the school fee remission. Our alliance also came up with a research report. We interviewed more than 300 kgs. Currently, the miscellaneous fees, including uniforms, snacks, refreshments, and so on, amount to more than $4,000, which is very expensive. Since the recommendations under the report will only be implemented by 2018 to 2019, would the government consider dispersing the subsidies sooner? I represent the KG Teachers Salary Concern Group. I'm aware that a lot of deputations have already spoken, and they represent students, parents, and teachers. But on behalf of our frontline KG teachers, I'd like to raise a few points. As an education practitioner, we have read the report on 15 years of free education, and we have to point out its shortfalls. In recent years, the government has taken up has been more committed towards free education, and commitment has increased from 2.8 billion to 4.1 billion in 2014 to 2015. We feel the need to improve preschool education, and it's very important for the future of Hong Kong as well. There are a lot of things we have to do, but we should establish priorities. Before the report was announced, we did our very best to voice our views. We did a petition and collected signatures from more than 7,000 KG teachers, but after the report was published, a lot of people were left disappointed. And why is that happening? I'd like to emphasize that the government has not solved the root of the problem in terms of teaching and learning. The government should make a bigger commitment towards safeguarding teachers' salaries. With regards to the pay scale, we have interviewed a number of KG teachers, and more than 80% are unhappy that the government cannot provide a clear standard pay scale. The report attempted to provide recommendations on the career ladder, but it has drawn a line on 300 students. So can the government explain the logic in establishing this level? Aged KGs can apply for further funding, but no details were given in the report. And there will be a recommended standard pay scale which KGs can take reference from. I'm not sure if this is a binding arrangement, and we would like to know the details. The starting salary is $18,000. So is that equivalent to 0.8 or 0.9? Can you clarify whether the starting salary belongs to 0.7 or 9? So that's all from the deputations today. We had 45 deputations for this session, and we've heard a number of views. Can the administration give a brief response? Under Secretary, please. Thank you very much. I'd like to thank all the friends and colleagues here today for your valuable comments. the comments you gave will be the basis for future consideration on our part. Generally speaking, a lot of the concerns were about the half-day or whole-day KGs, the salary scales for KG teachers, and subvention mode and so on. We talked about half-day versus whole-day KGs, so I'm not going to repeat myself here. For kids aged 2 to 3, compared with kids from 3 to 6, we actually have two separate approaches, as you all know. We are talking about 15 years of free education, and so we have not included kids aged 2 to 3 in this review. We know that some schools target kids aged 2 to 6, so when reviewing our measures, we would certainly consider those schools as well. But to extend our current plans to kids aged 2 to 3 is not viable. We are still ironing out the details, so we are very thankful for all your comments. For instance, the additional supporting staff for long whole day KGs, the 150 hours of professional training for teachers, how are we going to carry it out? And some deputations also mentioned the calculation methods and so on. We don't have detailed plans yet for a lot of these, but the report of the KG committee serve to offer general directions, and in the coming months, we will work out the details. Your comments, questions, and concerns will certainly be considered. And some deputations ask how we distinguish between big and small KGs. The standards at the moment are drawn by making comparisons with typical KGs in Hong Kong. And to incorporate this framework in our KGs is one of our key areas of work. And in deciding whether a KG has a vice principal or not would affect our amount of subvention. We hope to come up with a more straightforward or simpler method, but we need some time. For whole day KGs and half day KGs, we are not saying that we would only provide 25 or 30% of extra subvention to whole-day schools. They can charge higher school fees. And in recent years, the school fees for whole-day KGs is around 1.6 times as that for half-day KGs. So we would roughly share the fee with parents. So that's why we set the additional subvention level at about 30%. From the KG's perspectives, they can still charge the parents an extra 30%, so it should not hinder the operation of those KGs. So the only question that remains is that whether the government should provide full subvention to whole-day KGs. This is something we have to consider. The commission's idea, or the committee's idea, is that we should share the costs with the parents. We believe that the parents should chip in as well. But by offering whole day KG places, does it mean the government should bear the full cost? It's another question altogether. So we will continue to work on this. For whole day and long whole day KGs, we would provide 1 to 3 extra support staff. And with regards to the background qualifications of these people and the exact arrangements, we would need some time to work it out. That's all I want to say. Next, right now, members can ask questions according to Rule 83A of the Rules of Procedure. If members have any direct or indirect pecuniary interests, please declare such interests before you speak. Each member would have 4 minutes, including question and answer. So please indicate if you would like to speak. Mr. Tam Yuchong, and then myself, Mr. Tam Yuchong. I have no declaration of interest to make, but having heard what the deputation said today, a lot of them have been here a few times already, and I'd like to thank them for coming. Even though the report was already announced, there's still a lot of room for refining before the recommendations are implemented. We talked about half-day, whole-day, and long-whole-day KGs, and some deputations feel the amounts of resources invested is inadequate. I'm sure we can angle for more resources if necessary. But I don't agree with the view that whole day and long whole day KGs are not required, because the need really depends on the needs of parents, especially for families in which both parents are working. This is a very realistic situation we are looking at. And I think children enjoy the companionship of each other. They might not enjoy spending time with adults all the time. So I think they would have no problem spending more time in school. In the mainland, a lot of children would even reside in the schools and they would only go home once a week. On the salary pay scale, or on setting up such a pay scale for KG teachers, it's a matter of great concern to many. I hope this can be resolved. Dr. Choi Yeok Lin mentioned how the government would draw a line at 300 people, and the Undersecretary has not addressed this question. I'd like to know what he thinks. Undersecretary. Chairman, on the 300 people requirement, the committee drew a line on 300 people for the framework. If we have 300 students, how many teachers, senior teachers, and so on are needed? And under this assumption, the number of principals or vice principals can be established. So we have drawn a line at 300. So what happens to 299 or 301? For schools with less students, they might not require a vice principal from a management perspective. As I mentioned, we are still considering the implementation details of this framework, and we are considering whether to count the number of students or to convert it into a specific subvention amount, and so on. We are still thinking about the details. Or can we use a more straightforward approach and come up with a figure or an average figure for every student? So that means we no longer have to draw a line at 300 students. We can have a more gradual approach in order to alleviate the concerns. Do I have time to go on? Yes, we have ample time. On the minimum pay of $18,000, it's merely a suggestion at this stage. If for some reason it has to be delayed, we will certainly adjust the starting pay. If we establish a level of $18,000 and if we have to wait for 4 or 5 years before it's implemented, we'll certainly adjust the starting pay. And for the debate on half-day versus whole-day KGs, I seldom say whether half-day KGs or whole-day KGs are better. As I mentioned this morning, the committee's view is that quality KG education can be achieved in half-day schools, given that there are quality teachers and planning. But it doesn't mean that whole-day KGs are not worth supporting. But if we are to establish a set of guidelines for providing subvention, half-day KGs have become the starting point for reference. We do not intend to go into debates whether half-day or whole-day KGs are better, because there's no consensus in the academia.
To a great extent, it depends on the curriculum and the quality of the teachers. As for the pay scale, all along, we're of the view that you shouldn't view pay scales independently. We have to look at place allocation, how many classes in a KG, how many pupils in a class, etc., etc. For primary and secondary schools, every now and then you hear that we would like to reduce the number of classes. There are surplus teachers whom we have to handle, etc., etc. So it's not as simple as just a pay scale. So whether or not to adopt a pay scale for KGTs, we have to give regard to other factors as well. It's my turn, and then Mr. Christopher Jones. Today, we have 138 deputations or individual members of the public signing up. Most of them have come. Very rich comments were received. There are repeated issues as well as new issues. For example, we have ideas from school sponsors, views about NCS students, the needs of grassroots students, and so forth. Retirees from the education sector have told us their deep feelings. Young teachers have expressed their worries about the environment, their dissatisfaction over the systems, etc., etc. After discussing the subject for so long, I'd like the Education Bureau to come up with some new ideas. I don't think we will still dwell on which is better, half-day KGs or whole-day or long-whole-day KGs. We have received views not just from these 138 deputations, but other stakeholders and members of the public. For this matter, I hope the Education Bureau will no longer start from half-day KGs. As for the mode of subvention, you have to consider that at the same time. Otherwise, our discussions will be futile. For the KG sector, the early education sector, well, most of the deputations here are ladies. I myself did not have the experience in early childhood education. I understand that KGTs have always been very vibrant and amicable. Homework from pupils have always been colorful. KG life has been vibrant and energetic. These KGTs have come a number of times already. Still, they continue to come. So I hope that the government can give them a good answer. That good answer is to support them in early childhood education. They're not working for themselves. They come here for the younger generations. Without suitable support, the ultimate victims will be the students. Be it whole day or half day or the pay scale, I hope that the Education Bureau will seriously consider their views. Today, a number of details have been raised. The report has been quite vague on these points. For example, the size of 300 or 600. Why should there be such a differentiation? If you look at the scale of our KGs in Hong Kong, you'll see that the threshold shouldn't be 300 and 600. There's a soft indicator. That is 150 hours of training. Well, I give myself slightly more time. Now, where comes these indicators? For primary and secondary schools, they have similar indicators. Back then, our officials visited the mainland where they had indicators. So they took reference from the mainland. But they did not consider the fact that on the mainland, those training hours are within school hours. But now our own KGTs are to receive further training outside school hours. So I think these matters have to be taken up. Undersecretary, Chairman, concerning the issues raised by you, as I said at the beginning, we'll think about them when we come to the details. I'd like to thank our colleagues for their reminders today, particularly about early childhood education and the 150 hours of professional training. How should we go about it to make it practicable and feasible? Next, Mr. Christopher Chung. Thank you, Chairman. I'd like to present my own views. In Hong Kong, early childhood education will remain a problem. I think it's difficult to solve because most early childhood education is provided by the private sector. So you have to emphasize autonomy. At the same time, you want KGTs to have a fixed pay scale and fixed school hours, etc., like primary and secondary school teachers. I think the early childhood education sector has to think about this. What standard would you like to adopt to gauge the performance and quality of KGTs? So in the education sector, particularly in the early childhood education sector, you should think about this. Well, if most KGs are to be subvented by the government, then we may meet with opposition from the privately run KGs. I've been a member of the board of governors of KG. Eventually, that KG had to close. Well, KGs can be quite a profitable business. You have to encourage the investors. Well, let Mr. Chung finish. Some people, some school sponsors, can make a profit from early childhood education. However, KGTs don't have a fixed pay scale. So there is a conflict here. If most KGs are to be subvented by the government, well, think about it. What will happen? Some KGs are operating in commercial premises. Some in PRH estates. They're very different. This is different from primary and secondary schools. Most primary and secondary school campuses are subsidized by the government. Costs are lighter. The burden is lighter. But if you want autonomy, then you have to think of standardization as well. So do think about this. I want to see more discussion in the sector. I myself don't have any preconceived ideas, but I have observed such phenomena. Any member who would like to speak for a second time? If not, I'd like to speak for a second time, and I'll give myself 4 minutes. This morning I asked a question that's about the studies. We lack local studies, but there were some consultancy studies, consultants' reports. Executive summaries were given to us. I'd like to know whether members of the public can read those executive summaries as well. I've read part of the executive summary, which is not too different from the report itself. Can you make available to the public the whole report? I understand that some issues may be more sensitive. Well, you can black out those parts such that members of the public can read the whole report. They'll be able to know the justifications of certain proposals. They'll be able to read the data and so forth. Can I have some responses from the Bureau? Well, the executive summary has been passed to the LegCo. It's an open document already. Has it been uploaded to your website? Yes. As for the report itself, most of its contents are in the executive summary. As for the details, some information is rather sensitive, so we won't make them, we won't disclose them. Well, we want to know how you work out the salaries. What are the details relating to half-day and whole-day and long-whole-day KGs? Well, maybe rental levels are more sensitive. May I ask this? If you cannot make public the whole report, can you give us a longer executive summary? At the moment, this executive summary is quite hollow. We can only see the conclusions. Well, Chairman, after reading the executive summary, if you find areas that are ambiguous, you can write to me and I can explain again. I've mentioned our future work foci. We're prepare to discuss with LegCo members again. If you want to know more about any part of the executive summary, we can always provide you with supplementary answers. Well, that can be done. Well, I believe I have questions about the whole report. Just now, some of the friends here mentioned miscellaneous fees and charges. In future, in terms of regulation, will you consider such fees and charges? chairman will definitely consider the miscellaneous fees and charges. In the past, we did hear about these fees and charges sometimes at an excessive level. So we'll talk to the KG sector and carry out appropriate regulation. If members don't have further questions, I'd like to thank all of you for attending this meeting. The fourth session alone lasts almost 3 hours. So thank you very much, deputations and individual members of the public, and thank you, officials. Thank you.